When people think of the name Esther Jones, today they automatically think of Betty Boop, but she was much more than that. She was the Black Shirley Temple of her time. Esther Lee Jones was relatively known as Baby Esther, but rarely used the name Baby Esther in her act, and was better known as Little Esther. She is not to be confused for Esther Mae Jones, who is better known today in history as Esther Phillips. Both actresses used the exact same stage names in their careers, and were both Black child performers. The only difference was that they debuted in different time periods. Esther Lee Jones was active from 1923 to 1934, and Esther Mae Jones was active from the 1940s to the 1980s. Due to confusion, there are two images circulating the internet that are not the real Esther Jones. Reason for this was because historians were not sharing valid information, and some old news articles stated that Esther was a Negro woman, making it hard to locate her. This image here is not of Baby Esther, it is in fact a picture of a pretty Black college girl that was taken by African-American photographer James Van Der Zee in 1923. The real Esther Jones was only 4 years old in 1923. And this photo here is not Esther, it is a white model from the Ukraine who goes by the name Oyla. She posed for a Betty Boop photo set in 2008 by Retro Atelier. The model is Ukrainian. Gertrude Saunders, the Queen of the Blues, is also often mistaken for Baby Esther, due to her coming out as the original Boop girl. Gertrude Saunders was not Baby Esther, but was more or less the female originator of scat singing, who paved the way for others. Esther Jones was born in Chicago and was raised by her parents, Mr. and Mrs. Jones. Her career began in the early 1920s when she won first prize in a Charleston contest in Chicago. Then she was only four. In 1923, Russian-American theatrical manager Lou Bolton saw Esther performing at the Sunset Club in Chicago, Illinois, and offered to manage her. Lou Bolton conducted a theatrical school in the city of Pittsburgh where he taught children and adults dancing, singing, dramatic art and anything pertaining to the show business in general. When Esther debuted under the management of Lou Bolton, she was an acrobat and Charleston dancer, and she danced the streets of Chicago. Lou had been engaged in the business in the city of Chicago since 1922, and had been in show business for 20 years. Esther first debuted as Leal Esther, a play on Leal Farina, Alan Hoskins' character from the Bar Gang shorts, which is known as the Little Rascals comedy film shorts. Esther was often billed as Farina's kid sister. A 1926 article from the Exhibitors Herald states that Esther, a four-year-old colored girl Charleston dancer, stepped the house into a riot. Esther continued to work under Lou Bolton, and by 1928, she was given some notability. In 1928, Esther used to perform regularly at the Everglades nightclub, where she would impersonate her idol the late great Florence Mills, among other famous Black stars. Florence Mills started out as a child performer, similar to Esther Jones. Only Florence was known as Baby Flo, and sometimes Baby Florence. Florence became famous later in life, replacing Gertrude Saunders in the all-Black Broadway musical, Shuffle Along, and had a lot of imitators. Esther Jones was one of them. The others were Baby Delian, who used to perform at the Cotton Club, and Baby Cox, better known as Gertrude Cox. Mills was a great dancer, who also sung, and Mills also was notable for doing the Charleston. In history, it is often mistaken that Esther Jones performed regularly at the Cotton Club in Harlem. It was actually Baby Delian. Esther Jones toured various cities in America, and performed in a variety of places throughout her early career. One night in 1928, while performing at the Everglades nightclub, Esther's 60-year-old father William Jones and 34-year-old Lou Bolton were arrested and held on $500 bail by Magistrate Francis McQuaid for permitting 7-year-old Esther Jones to give singing and dancing imitations of the late Florence Mills, without obtaining a permit. Both were fined $100 in special sessions and pleaded guilty to the charge. They were arrested on the complaint of agents of the Children's Society after the latter had witnessed Esther Jones, the minor daughter of the defendants, do an imitation of Florence Mills. The police officers told the justice that Esther did her act at the club at 9 p.m. and again about midnight. After that fallback, victory came Esther's way when she was booked for a Movietone through William Morris for MGM, flanked by a 26-piece orchestra from the Capitol Theater, New York City. The Times Union stated in a 1928 article that Esther was Harlem's miniature, and at one show was manipulated into taking center stage, making Mrs. Nerlinger, Doris Nerlinger's mother, burst into tears. By 1929, Esther had hit the headlines. One headline stated that she had finally fallen into good luck, but gave most of the credit to Lou Bolton. The article stated that Esther had finished 4 years training under Bolton's management and won a European engagement through her New York success. It also went on to state that her eccentric dancing and inimitable singing placed her in a position as the most phenomenal juvenile in the profession. Esther also appeared at a Jewish Guild benefit in 1929, which was an annual benefit for the charity fund of the Jewish Theatrical Guild of America. Other well-known artists of the day that appeared were Sophie Tucker, Jackson and Durante, William Morris, Loni Haskell, Captain Irving O'Hay, among others. Esther was set for a 6 weeks engagement at the Empire in Paris and set off on the Leviathan, with her mother Mrs. Jones and her manager Lou Bolton. Before setting off, Harrison Godwin Smith furnished Esther with several songs for her European tour. The songs included, The Turtle Walk, My Little Dixie Walk, I've Got the Blues for Dixieland, and I Need a Man Around My House. Once Esther made it to France, she proved to be a sensation and was dubbed the miniature Josephine Baker. Esther opened at the Empire, and did exceptionally well as a red-hot interpreter of the latest in jazz music, and drawed considerable applause after each performance. At the Casino de Paris, Josephine Baker personally met up with Esther Jones and presented her on stage with a box of candy. Esther was heartily applauded by the audience. On another stage in Paris, Esther shared a bill with Carlos Gardel, and the roller skating acrobats Van Horn and Inez, and a chimpanzee called Djibo, who did a trapeze routine. On the 19th of March, Esther's manager Lou Bolton suddenly left for New York on the America. The news stated that it was understood that Jacques Garner, an interpreter, stirred up trouble. But that was far from the truth. Lou Bolton had Jim Crowed Esther's mother Mrs. Jones, and had passed her off as a maid of her child while filling private engagements at private homes, which resulted in Lou Bolton being fired, and being replaced by new manager Sidney Garner, a black Parisian from New York, who had lived in Europe for 16 years, and was well acquainted with the theatrical business in Europe. Garner also had the ability to speak in several languages, and served as secretary and interpreter for many black stars, among them being Johnny Hudgens. Garner stated that Esther was now under his direction, and had made a great hit in France, and everyone would say, "Isn't she wonderful, marvelous, extraordinary, this little Esther? A miracle, that was so clever." Every magazine had her in their columns, and she created a bigger sensation than Josephine Baker. Garner also went on to say that Lou Bolton tried to draw a color line in Paris, which was his biggest mistake, and that he took advantage of Esther and her family. He gave Esther's mother Mrs. Jones $5, which was a scandal in Paris, so Mrs. Jones asked Sidney to take care of her. When Esther arrived in Paris, she was greatly in need of clothes, on account of Lou being stingy to buy her some, and after being put under Garner's management became one of the best-dressed child artists in France. Before filling her engagements in Paris, Esther appeared at the Moulin Rouge, then headed off for Spain Madrid, in which she proved to be a hit and made her mark there in history. According to data, when Esther sung she sounded like a flute, very high-pitched. While touring Europe she delighted audiences including kings and queens. In Spain she played for King Alfonso. In Sweden King Gustav and the Queen came to the theatre especially to see her. In France, Germany and Sweden and other countries Esther also gave private performances for the nobility and high society. Esther Jones' first appearance was at the Moulin Rouge. In Paris, Esther was known as the miniature Josephine Baker. Audiences raved over her in the Parisian papers, Daily and Illustrated gave much space to her. Vogue, leading Illustrated Weekly, devoted the entire front cover to her picture and a full page in the interior. Esther would sing, dance, do the splits and generally carried on to the great delight of her audiences and was dubbed as being too cute for words. The London Sunday People, in its review of Paris plays, said of Baby Esther, "Thousands flock no longer to the Moulin Rouge to see Miss Dingwood herself or the clever American ballet girls, or the beautiful women of the chorus, but to applaud a little mite, 10-year-old, who has won fame and wealth within the space of a few weeks. We are living in an age of speed, but this amazing little child has broken every record of sudden theatrical success." Despite being African-American, whenever Esther Jones appeared on the streets or in restaurants, she was always the center of admiring crowds, and many people were anxious to speak to her. And with it all, she was unspoiled as the average child, black or white. Vu described Esther Jones as dressed in a costume with spangles like some brilliant little butterfly. The light of the projectors is shining on her. With surprise, one realizes that her flute-like voice comes distinctly to each in the audience. Because she sings at first, her body softly swaying to the accompaniment of the popular American songs that she interprets with a very seductive mixture of seriousness and childish mischief. After appearing at the Folies Bergère, the Empire, and other leading Paris theaters and cafes, she went to Spain, where the audiences and the press went wild over her. But it was in Stockholm, Sweden, that she caused the biggest sensation. This was not only because of her work, but because the leading Swedish restaurant owner drew the color line against her. Baby Esther traveled with her mother and her new manager Sydney Garner, who was also black. When the party entered the restaurant, the owner Brenda Thompson, who had lived in America, was catering to white Americans, refused service. At this, Mr. Garner demanded that a glass of milk be brought for the child, and when the owner still refused, Mr. Garner sent for the police. Other guests in the establishment voiced their indignation at Thompson's conduit, and to show how thoroughly they disapproved of it, several of them gave the party invitations to their homes, among the number being a Swedish baron. The next morning, every Stockholm paper carried articles denouncing the lone apostle of Jim Crow. The Swedish Blad called the incident the greatest scandal Stockholm has ever had. It asked, "Has the owner of a restaurant the right to behave the way he likes to customers who visit his place?" That was the question asked in Stockholm. The glass of milk that was refused Esther has caused as much indignation as a real crime. A correspondent to this same paper wrote, "I hope that the colored persons who were refused service at Thompson's will not think that all Swedish people are like that. The Swedish people are indignant over the affair." The Jim Crow restaurant was eventually closed, while Baby Esther's popularity rose higher than ever. Offers poured in on her, and on leaving Stockholm, thousands of children with flowers came to see her off. While touring Germany, Esther appeared in talkies for the Excelsior film Co. of Berlin. And while touring Europe, Esther mastered many languages. Esther continued her success in South America. In Rio de Janeiro, Buenos Aires, Sao Paulo and Montevideo, she proved to be a sensation. At Rio de Janeiro, American Ambassador Morgan came to see her play, and after her performance came backstage to congratulate her. He said that it was simply marvelous that she could sing in so many different languages, and invited her to sing for him at the American Embassy. Accompanying Esther was Gordon Stretton, who was known as the Prince of Wales's favorite jazz entertainer. In the course of the evening, the President of Brazil expressed to Sydney Garner his great pleasure at seeing such capable black American artists in Brazil. According to an American newspaper that reported on Esther's success, Esther was clever but was not good enough to play a top C in Blackbirds. Esther Jones returned to America in 1933, but didn't make much of an impact as she had done in Europe and South America. Esther continued touring the United States and became a singer and dancer for Cab Calloway and his orchestra. In 1934, Esther's name was brought up in a Betty Boop lawsuit. Helen Kane, who claimed to be originator of Boop Boop a Doop, tried to sue Paramount Pictures, a company she used to work for, and the Fleischer Studios, who made the Betty Boop cartoons. Paramount and the Fleischer Studios were not having any of that, so they got people to research the origins of Boop Boop a Doop, which linked to all black clubs and cabarets in Harlem. Lew Bolton, Baby Esther's ex-manager, went into court and told the judge that Helen Kane had saw Baby Esther perform in 1928 at the Everglades nightclub, with her then-manager Tony Shane, who was also booking agent for Esther Jones in 1928. He said they had ringside seats and both saw Esther Scat singing, and not too long after, Helen had appropriated Esther's style, and became famous overnight. Marion Luba, a nightclub dancer, testified that she saw Baby Esther Scat sing at an Atlantic City, New Jersey nightclub in 1928. And several other witnesses claimed that they had boop-boop-a-dooped before Kane, including African-American composer Clarence Williams, who stated he was the true originator of the sounds. Clarence was married to Eva Taylor, who was part of the cast in the musical Shuffle Along, the same musical that featured curly-haired beauty Gertrude Saunders. In her act, Esther would dance, make funny faces, roll her eyes and interpolated words such as boo-boo-boo, wah-da-da, doo-doo-doo, and doo-doo-da-doo-ha-da, wah-da-da-da, boo-da-doo-doo, low-di-da-doo, and would finish off her routine with a da-doo. Some of these patterns can be heard clearly in two of Helen Kane's first two recordings, which proves that Kane had adapted the sounds she had heard at the Everglades nightclub months earlier, by putting them into her hit song, I Wanna Be Loved By You. Footage of Esther performing in this style was shown in court. Esther was shown singing two Helen Kane songs, including her own unique wah-da-da scat song. The footage showed Esther performing Don't You Like That and Is There Anything Wrong in That? Although in the 20s and 30s, it was quite common for singers to cover the same songs, as there are several renditions of those hit songs by a galaxy of performers. During the trial, Lou Bolton told the court that he had no idea where Esther was and thought that she was still in Paris, forgetting to mention that he was fired several years prior for Jim Crowing Esther and her family. False information that is usually passed around is that Esther died, which is not true. It is false information spread by fabricators and people who try to whitewash history. Helen was outed as not being original, and she tried to appeal her case, only to lose because her voice couldn't be copyrighted back then, and one of the main facts was that she looked like every other woman of the 20s, most notably Paramount's top star Clara Bow, and had also adapted her scat singing from African-American nightclubs, making her scatting not unique, and that singers from the 1900s had already sung in the high-pitched baby style before her, which made her singing style quite common. Irene Franklin, with her 1909 recording of I've Got the Mumps, was one of the earlier baby singers. It also came out in 1934 that Gertrude Saunders was the original female scat singing sensation, and had done it before Helen Kane, Betty Boop, and Esther Jones. Gertrude debuted in Shuffle Along, where she first originated her scat technique, and was tributed as the original boop-boop-a-doop girl, up until the late 1950s. Today, Gertrude Saunders is better known as Bessie Smith's rival. African Americans originated jazz and scat singing, making it make sense as to where the origins lie. Although according to Grim Natwick, who was the creator of Betty Boop, when he was creating Betty Boop, he had used a photograph of Helen Kane, and then Paramount and the Fleischer Studios decided to cash in on the act that Helen had became famous for, even going to the length of hiring impersonators. Helen Kane impersonators hired to play the role of Betty Boop were Margie Hines, the original voice of Betty Boop, Catherine Wright, Little Ann Little, Bonnie Poe, and the most famous being, Mae Questel. Helen Sugar Kane's singing style may have not been original, but she created her own persona by adapting baby style, one in which every girl of the 20s wanted to imitate, which led to the creation of Betty Boop. With no Helen Kane, today there would be no Betty Boop. Betty Boop playing Dangerous Nan McGrew, a year after Helen Kane, proves that Betty was a caricature of her. Esther did not comment on the Betty Boop trial, but she returned to the vaudeville stage in 1934 under the name Little Esther. She was also advised by the Afro-American newspaper to sue Helen Kane, but did not pursue Helen. By 1934, Esther was a young woman, and would have been in her teen years. In April 1934, Esther debuted as a stage attraction. According to the Muncie Evening Press, she was a red-hot dancer. In May, Esther was booked by the National and was billed the sepia dancing doll. The Courier Journal from Louisville, Kentucky stated the following, Little Esther, a sepia dancing girl, appears as an added attraction with the stage show, and is said to be one of the youngest vaudeville artists to have achieved success on three continents. She has appeared in practically every theater of consequence in the United States and Canada. Remained 4 months at the Empire Theater in Paris, then played lengthy engagements in Berlin. After touring in 1934, Esther seems to have retired from show business, most likely due to not having the same appeal she had when she was younger. She was called Baby Esther, because she was a child performer, but as said, also used two other variations, which were Lil Esther and Little Esther. In recent media, Esther is better known as Betty Boop's great black grandmother and has been tributed for several Black History Months. When people talk about Baby Esther, they often spread misinformation, due to internet sources that stated that Esther was a woman. A tribute song entitled Baby Esther was written specially for her by singer Kyle Dion, in which Esther was portrayed by a model who wore Betty Boop apparel. True research proves that Esther was not the model for Betty Boop, but was more part of the origins for Betty Boop's scat singing. People often twist the Baby Esther story to their liking. When the story first came out, it caused major outrage in the black community. After that died down, and everyone moved on. But then there was a Helen Kane club that surfaced and tried to discredit Baby Esther by stating that she never existed and that she was a nobody. It took the Betty Boop Wikia, Betty Boop Lover and Betty Boop Wikia top pages blogs to uncover the truth and real facts, and after 2 years research, the real Baby Esther story came to light, proving she existed. It's not the fact that Baby Esther was Betty Boop, because she wasn't, it was the fact that she was part of the origin of the character's scat singing, that was the main focus. Also that people were discrediting Helen Kane, for something she herself had made famous, and just twisting the story in general on both sides, which was all down to lack of sources. Historians, particularly white ones, knew the origins of Baby Esther, but would not share her other stage names, which is what led to the whole confusion. But it's not their faults, as humans, we all can be wrong at times. Also, the truth always comes out in the end, and won't be silenced. So if the truth does trigger you, you shouldn't be here watching the video, go about your way, and continue spreading your fabrications. Also to note, there are a lot of wannabe Betty Boops or Helen Kanes, whatever they are, spreading misinformation and trying to discredit people. Word of advice, nobody cares, we all know the truth, continue hating hoes. The real Baby Esther started out as a Florence Mills impersonator, so when you look at Baby Esther, think of the great Florence Mills, who replaced Gertrude Saunders in the musical Shuffle Along. No audio recordings or video footage of Esther has survived. Paramount used footage and photos of Esther in court, but most likely got rid of the footage after the trial had taken place. Esther Jones did, however, appear on radio shows, and in several lost films, including an MGM Movietone and several in Europe. When you hear, boop boop be doop, boop boop a doop, or, boop boop a doop, please think of the African-American origination of scat singing and jazz. This video was narrated by Robotina de Loop-a-Doop, who was annoying as hell, like seriously.